It's called Camp LaGuardia.
Dangerous on the barracks. I was a kid, you almost got killed myself. It's dangerous. They use knives and all that stuff. I seen a guy with his guts cut open. I'm scared myself. I'm scared. I'm not kidding you. I'm afraid every night when I go to the flop house. On the county jack rollers. Walk the streets, them jack rollers walk the streets day and night. They don't ever sleep. My pocket was torn from night before last. I had $18 in my pocket. They seen the bill sticking out, you know. My pocket was torn. He snatched the bills out of my pocket and then he took off, you know. But I grabbed one of them, you know. When I grabbed one of them, the other guy said, leave him alone there. It's my buddy. I said, well, he's got my money. So I had to leave him alone.
For the very old and the very sick, life on the Bowery has gotten too hard. A new breed of derelict, younger, stronger, many of them junkies, stalk the old men on the streets and in the broken-down hotels. Trapped in narrow rooms, easy victims in the open dormitories of flap houses like the Palace, the Uncle Sam House, the Prince, they run the very real risk of having their welfare checks, Social Security money, and veterans' pensions stolen, and their bodies battered. Some of them huddle in the city's overcrowded men's shelter on East 3rd Street, where 1,400 are fed every day. But others decide they can no longer survive in New York, and for them, Camp LaGuardia, the city's upstate home for penniless, forgotten men, is another place to go.
Well, a forgotten man, if he's on the Bowery, and he wants to change his way of life or get away from here, all he has to do is ask to go to camp. We'll make the arrangements. And hopefully at camp, he can find himself. And at Camp LaGuardia, there are no forgotten men. They're all taken care of very, very well.
Every Tuesday and Thursday, 20 to 30 men wait for 2, sometimes 3 hours in a bullpen for the bus to leave for camp. Social service regulations require that each man be searched for weapons and alcohol.
Please put down your suitcases and open them. Open your bags, but you don't have to open it up, sir.
How'd you go? Give me last name.
Awesome.
I'm give me last name.
Some of the men head upstate with high expectations.
Come on.
I'm looking for self-respect, health, and getting back home to my family, and a job of some security that I can make enough money to take back home to my family to show them that at least that I haven't been doing too bad out here in this world. I left them that way, and I hope to return the same way I left them.
Camp LaGuardia is located on a green hill in rolling farm country 90 miles north of New York. Built in 1918 as the Great Court Prison for Women, the camp's main building houses 400 men in double bunks in old prison cells 6 by 7 feet.
Each cell, or room as we call them now, has a double bunk with 2 occupants.
How many men live in here?
2 men, 2 lockers. We try to get a chair in. Doesn't leave much room, but this is the best we have to offer. And they're all primarily the same, as you can see. Some are cleaner than others, and that all depends on the occupant. And our aides make their rounds every morning and every afternoon, and as much as they possibly can. and try to get the men to keep themselves clean.
What are some of the other major problems you have here? You told me about mental patients now coming in here.
Well, we only have 3 psychiatrists, and they visit once a week each.
How many former mental patients are now at Camp LaGuardia?
Quite a few. More than in previous years.
40%?
Oh, I would say about 40.
That comes to more than 400 men?
About.
Does that create a problem for you?
Yes, because we're understaffed and we haven't... We can't do as much for the men as we really would like to.
How many men are in Camp LaGuardia now?
Right now, with the bus in, about 1,030 men.
And how many full-time staff do you have?
61 or 62.
Is that enough?
Definitely not. Definitely not.
Is the plumbing adequate for the 1,000 men who live here?
No. No. Perfect example is this tier right here. You have 3 toilet bowls, 2 showers, and 1 wash sink.
What are the problems with the plumbing?
Well, most of this plumbing's been in here since the place was built, and I guess that goes back 50 years or better. So all we can do is patch up, and we have only 1 maintenance man. He does his best. We have no plumber.
In 2 outside barracks, there are 400 more men in double bunks, with 1 sink for every 50. In the South Warehouse barracks, an old cinder block warehouse, 200 men live in a space 75 by 75 feet. There are 85 double bunks, 1 exit, and no fire prevention system. The camp cafeteria seats 160 men. 1,000 eat during every meal period. Each man gets about 15 minutes to eat his food. Most of the men at camp are chronic alcoholics with both other physical and mental problems. A third suffer from emphysema. Half have arrested tuberculosis. And 20% of the men have had strokes. The camp has 1 full-time doctor. The city spends $3.61 a day on each man, and every man is required to work in the laundry room, the tailor shop, on the grounds. Some work for 16 cents, others for 8 cents an hour. Most of this money is turned over to the institution. There's no work supervision, just 1 recreation worker for all the men, and no attempt at rehabilitation. The camp administration doesn't try and deny or hide the fact that the camp is understaffed, that its facilities are inadequate. They say they simply must have more money. In fact, the camp will receive $747,000 this year for the renovation of bathrooms, new steam pipes, and better lighting. But the problems of overcrowding and staff will remain. Some of the men have been at camp for as long as 20 years. Others come for 2 or 3 months, dry out, but then return to the Bowery. Hugh McAlpine lives in cell 38 on Tier 2.
When I came here, my teeth were wicked. Believe me, I was ashamed to open my mouth. And I was drinking an awful lot, and that didn't help my teeth any. And I always had severe headaches and pains in my mouth. And I came here, and I got teeth. And my doctor, the dentist here, worked very hard, extra time on my teeth. And then they gave me glasses. I was in need of glasses, and they gave me glasses. And I see better, and since I've been here 2 years, I feel pretty good.
Is there something you miss up here?
Yes, I miss my wife and children very much, but I will never see them again. My daughter's name is Linda Joy. That's a beautiful name, and my son's name is Hugh Michael.
Tell me about them.
Well, they're just cute children. My daughter, I believe, has this infantile paralysis, something like that. She'll be crippled the rest of her life. She's born that way. But my son is a handsome-looking fellow. And my wife is a pretty woman. But drinking just got us apart. Drink, drink, drink. And I ignore my son. I wouldn't take him out. I kept nagging with my wife, so one day I come home, everything was gone. My wife left a note. She said, life cannot go on this way. You're a wonderful person and all that, but that drink, she says no, and she left. That was it. And I missed him very much, but there's not much I can do about it. I know that somewhere, someday, he'll turn out to be better than a man than I will ever be. I hope he does.
Some of the men still can't do without whiskey, and they sneak into town at night to buy it.
Around here, they call them runners. You know, a few of the men, they get a couple bucks up from payday or whatnot, and they give a certain man a, you know, amount of money, and he'll run down into town, bring the wine up. It's not really that. It's because we're understaffed and we can't watch over 1,000 men. So they get a little loop, and a couple times they'll be walking the tracks, and they have been hit.
By what?
The train. And there's nothing really we can do much about until we get more staff. Now, you know, if the city would realize it, we are having problems. Like at night time where it's usually done, this is when our amount of staff is usually at the least. About 4 or 5 men to look after 1,000.
Are you happy here now?
Well, I wouldn't know what you'd call happy, but I think I'm more safer here than I would be in the streets. From what I hear, men have shipped out of here, and 2 or 3 weeks later, they come back, and from their reports, it's pretty rough all over the place.
Are you going to live here for the rest of your life?
I don't know. God willing, I really don't know what I'm going to do. As far as I know, and as far as I care, I could die tomorrow. I mean, it's just a way of life. I've been here 2 years, and I've fallen right into the pattern of things. I'm 50 years old now, and, well, I figure I'm going downhill now. After I figured I reached 50, well, it's downhill from now on.
Well, this is our morgue. When a man dies in camp, he's usually checked by the doctor. And then we put him in a body bag. We bring him down here, and he stays maybe a day or 2 days till the city of New York can send a morgue wagon down. And then they bring him back up to New York. It's a shame, you know, that they don't have enough medical care. I think that's one of the reasons. A lot of guys, I feel, you know, really shouldn't have died. But like in New York City, they bring him here. I mean, they send him down. Like we've had one man that was sent down here, and the next day he died. I don't think this is right. I think the men should have more medical assistance.
Up here?
Right. Even here and in New York City. Like, the doctor only comes maybe 2 hours a day, and we really don't have the facilities to take care of the men.
You've seen men die here. Does it bother you?
Yes, it bothers me in a way. At first, when I got here, first man I saw, it was pretty bad. But as time goes on, you get used to it. You know, the things, you know the men are going to die, so sort of build up a thing in your mind that you're just going to have to go along with it. Face reality. Men do die.
Are you happy here?
Well, certainly. You get friendship, everything you need. What more could you ask?
Do you feel people love you here?
I think they like me. They holler hooray when they see me coming with a banjo. I think the majority just go for me because I got a good personality. I help them out. I make rings for them. And fix up things for them. It's out the shop here. That's the hobby shop out there.
Do you ever get lonely when you think about the past?
No. I don't think about the past.
What do you think about?
I'm thinking about today and what I'm going to do today and what I'm going to do tomorrow. And I never give up. I say I can and I will and I do. I do. That's what they like about me. Well, I come up, shook hands with me the other night. He says, I like you because you do something. I says, I can and I will and I do. Can't never done anything, but can do it. If you believe in yourself, you can make it. I've got a pool and a $10 bill. I know a spot right over the hill. There's a pop and a dance. If you wanna have some fun, come along with me. Hey there, baby, and I don't.